Good evening, good morning, welcome everyone, wherever you are watching from in the world. I believe we have over 1100 registered participants, so a big welcome and an applause if you were in an auditorium for Professor Chetty. I'm absolutely delighted and extremely honored to welcome Professor Raj Chetty, the 2020 Infosys Laureate for Economics, to deliver the Infosys Prize Lecture. On behalf of Ashoka University and the newly set up Center for Economic Data and Analysis, CEDA, welcome Professor Chetty. Raj Chetty is one of the youngest tenured professor in Harvard University's history. Born in India, he moved to the US as a very young boy, still in elementary school, with his parents. He completed his PhD at the age of 23 from Harvard, joined the faculty of UC Berkeley before returning to his alma mater as professor. Along with collaborators, he set up a fantastic website called Opportunity Insights, which has developed the Opportunity Atlas based on anonymous data following about 20 million Americans. And the Atlas actually allows us to answer questions such as which neighborhoods in America allow Americans to have the best chance to climb out of poverty. His prodigal scholarship has been widely recognized. He's won every prestigious award that the discipline has to offer, including the John Bates Clark Medal given to economists under 40 and so on. His list of achievements and awards is enormous, and I'm not going to spend more time reading all the names of the different awards. But I do want to talk a little bit about Professor Chetty's research. Professor Chetty's research is extraordinary in its scope because it includes fields that prima facie appear unrelated. He's worked on public finance, on tax policy, social insurance, risk preference, education, intergenerational mobility, and inequality. And the interesting thing is that he examines these issues not within, but across the disciplinary, subdisciplinary silos. And that's what makes his work extremely unique, because we are so used to looking at issues within silos. So it's a very refreshing, to read work that cuts across the silos. His pioneering scholarly work and teaching methods reflect actually really big shifts that have begun to reshape the way in which teaching and research goes off in the field of economics. He uses big data on micro units, but he examines macro questions, big picture questions about inequality, employment, education, etc. And this shows how focusing on the individual, you can draw conclusions about issues that are so fundamental to human lives. But it also showcases the tremendous discipline, the tremendous reach that the discipline of economics has to offer to shape actual outcomes in people's lives. It makes the bridge. His work makes the bridge between theory and practice, and most importantly, it harnesses the largely untapped potential power of big data to allow scholars to join the dots between various elements that we are used to thinking of as disparate elements. And I think this is, it's important to recognize that this is especially important when big data is being, is under a lot of cloud, because we've seen uses of big data for nefarious purposes. But Professor Chetty's work exemplifies the best possible use of big data to make a difference to human lives, to increase human welfare. His work is focused on the US primarily, but it has tremendous potential. And I hope that in today's talk, he addresses a few parts, but particularly about using Indian data that he normally, his work does not focus on. And I hope going forward that he extends his analysis to India as well. Before I hand over the mic to Raj, I would like to inform the audience a little bit about CEDA, the Center for Economic Data and Analysis, that we have just set up at the Ashoka University. These are our first steps towards compiling summary statistics from publicly available data sources, and we are aiming to make CEDA a data hub going forward. And what we are building is a data portal, which the beta version of which we'll unveil today, It's very much a work in progress. And we have a feedback form because we are very aware of the various glitches that users might encounter, and we want to improve upon it. The opportunity atlas that Raj Chetty and his colleagues have established is what we want to be when we grow up. And we are obviously not there yet. But I'm going to just show you a few glimpses of what the data set is going to look like. And then I'll hand over the mic to Professor Chetty. So basically, it's a user-driven and interactive data portal that allows users to generate and download visualizations, heat maps, bar charts, graphs, etc., on a large range of socioeconomic data that we've compiled from different publicly available data sources. And users can make connections across data sets, across geographies, across time, and across social groups, and make connections across two different data sets that typically it's hard to make connections across. So for example, you can make heat maps using NSS, census, NFHS, et cetera. You filter across time, geography, and so on. You can even compare variables by generating heat maps at the district level, state level, and so on. And there is a list of, this is just a tiny glimpse, but basically there's a list of all the variables. When you click on any of these, you'll be taken into a further drop-down menu. You can choose the variables that you want to look at and generate the visualization that that would work for you. And so this is CEDA, and today is a little, the birth of the CEDA data portal. It's a really small baby step, but we are inspired by the Opportunity Atlas, and we hope in a few weeks or even months to get there eventually. So with this, I hand over the mic to Professor Raj Chetty. Please type your questions in the chat box, and I will read them out to Professor Chetty at the end of the talk. Floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Dr. Deshpande, for the very warm introduction. It's really a privilege and an honor to be here with all of you, even though I'm across the world. Great to have a chance to speak with all of you, and an honor to have received the Infosys Prize and to be able to deliver this lecture. I'm also very happy to hear about the data efforts at CEDA, and I will talk at the end of what I discussed today about how I think there's tremendous potential in India to do work analogous to what I'm going to discuss, focusing primarily on the US. So let me share my screen here. And so hopefully you're seeing a set of slides here. And so let me dive in. I'm going to speak about how we can improve equality of opportunity, which is the topic, as Professor Deshpande mentioned, our research group here at Harvard has been focusing on for the past several years. I'm going to focus primarily on data from the US because that is where some of the best data currently exists, and that's where our group has been focusing. But I'll talk at the end, as I mentioned earlier, about how I think there are many analogous themes that are likely to emerge in India and other countries, and I think there's tremendous potential to do analogous work in India as well. So I'm going to talk about how I think the roots of economic opportunity and upward mobility, kids rising up in the income distribution, really emerge at a very local level. But I'm going to start at a much bigger picture level by talking about the American dream, which I'm sure you all have heard of in India. Certainly when I was growing up in India, there was this sense that America was a place where through hard work, anyone had a chance of moving up and achieving, kind of unbounded potential. And so in this first slide that I'm going to share with you here, my colleagues and I, in a paper we wrote a few years ago, set about to assess the extent to which America actually lives up to that image that I think it has globally. And the way we did that is to focus on one statistic that we think measures a key aspect of the American dream. To what extent do children go on to earn more than their parents did? And so in particular, the statistic we're computing here is what fraction of kids go on to earn more than their parents did, measuring both kids' and parents' incomes in their mid-30s and adjusting for inflation. And we're looking at that data by the year in which the child was born. And so what you can see if you look at the left side of this chart is that for kids born back in the middle of the last century, kids born in the 1940s and 1950s, it was a virtual guarantee that you were going to achieve the American dream of moving up relative to your parents. 92% of children born in 1940 in America went on to earn more than their parents did. But if you look at what has happened over time, you see a dramatic fading of the American dream, such that for kids born in the 1980s, who are turning 30 around now, it's now become only a 50-50 shot as to whether you are going to do better than your parents. Achieving the American dream has become a coin flip. So this dramatic trend is, of course, of great interest to economists because it reflects a fundamental change in the U.S. economy. But I think it's also of great interest from a political and social perspective, because our sense is that it's this very trend that underlies a lot of the frustration that people around America and to some extent around the world are expressing, that, you know, it's no longer as easy to get ahead as it once was. And so, motivated by this trend, in our research and policy group at Harvard, Opportunity Insights, we are focused on essentially understanding what is driving that trend that I just showed you, and, you know, the broader question of how can we restore the American dream going forward. So that is, of course, a very big question, the drivers of inequality and opportunity in America and elsewhere around the world. And there are lots of people who for years have studied those questions. So what is our approach? What do we seek to contribute to that debate? Well, our angle, as Professor Deshpande mentioned, is to bring the power of big data to study how to increase upward mobility. Now, we all hear all the time about big data in the context of the tech sector, for example, with modern companies using large data sets to improve the products they offer. Analogously, our vision is that large data sets can be used to answer critical economic and social policy questions. In this case, how can we increase rates of upward mobility? Now, the way we're going to take these large data sets and analyze them, there are many different directions in which you can go. The way we are going to organize things is to look at a broad range of interventions from a life course perspective, from childhood to adulthood. So rather than focusing on any one policy domain, many of you might think about education, for example, as a key area for intervention. And I will talk about the role of education, but I'll also talk about issues like affordable housing policy or social capital as other types of things that might matter here, looking at a broad range of interventions rather than any one particular area. Now, the starting point for a lot of what I'm going to talk about today and a lot of our analysis is that there are very sharp local differences in rates of upward mobility across areas. And so to show you that, I'm going to turn to this map here, which illustrates the geography of upward mobility in the United States. So let me first describe how this map is constructed, and then I'll talk about what I think we learned from it. So what we're doing here is taking data on 20 million kids, essentially all kids born in the US in the early 1980s. And we're using anonymized data from tax returns to link them to their parents and link them to the specific area in which they're born. And using that data, we're splitting the US into 740 different metro and rural areas. And within each of those areas, we're calculating a simple statistic that measures the rate of upward mobility for kids who grew up there. So in particular, we're measuring the average income at age 35 for kids who grew up in low-income families, families at the 25th percentile of the US national income distribution, that is families earning about $27,000 a year. We color the map so that areas in red and orange colors are areas with lower levels of upward mobility, and blue-green colors are areas with higher levels of upward mobility. So if you start by looking at the scale in the lower right side of your screen, you can see that there's a tremendous amount of spectrum in rates of upward mobility in the United States, even for kids who are growing up in the 1980s, entering the labor market today. So in particular, if I look at places in the center of the country, Dubuque, Iowa, for example, kids who grow up there in low-income families earning $27,000 a year have incomes on average in adulthood of $45,000 a year. So quite a substantial rate of upward mobility across one generation. By contrast, if you look at much of the southeastern part of the country, or cities like Cincinnati or Detroit or Charlotte, North Carolina, you see that kids who are growing up in families at the same level of income, $27,000 a year, one generation later, they actually have lower incomes on average in Charlotte, North Carolina. So the key point to take away from this map is that there's tremendous variation in rates of upward mobility across different parts of the United States. So that initial chart that I showed you of the fading American dream actually conceals a tremendous amount of variation in the present day across different parts of the country. So when we first constructed this map a few years ago, you know, naturally, I think there are two questions that emerge from it. First, from a scientific point of view, what is it that's driving this sharp variation in rates of upward mobility across different areas? That's very useful as a lens to understand what the drivers of economic mobility might be in the United States, and perhaps, as I'll talk about at the end of the talk, elsewhere around the world as well. So I think there's a pure academic or scientific interest in anytime you see variation like this, understanding what is going on. But second, and perhaps more importantly, I also think there's a direct policy interest in understanding what's driving this variation, because if we can figure out, for instance, why rates of upward mobility are relatively high in a place like the San Francisco Bay Area and Silicon Valley or in Salt Lake City, perhaps we can translate those lessons to increasing upward mobility in the more red and orange colored areas. And so motivated by those two, I think, reasons, what I'm going to do in this talk is essentially discuss a set of hypotheses, some of which you might already have in your mind for what's driving this variation in upward mobility across areas. And I'll talk about how we evaluated each of these hypotheses systematically, and then finally talk about what their implications are for policy to increase upward mobility going forward. So hypothesis number one that economists usually come up with when they see this map is that maybe this is about differences in the types of jobs or the labor markets in different parts of the country. So you all know, for example, that the Bay Area has a very vibrant tech sector with Silicon Valley that's growing very rapidly. You know, so maybe that's the reason that we're seeing very high rates of upward mobility for kids who grow up in the Bay Area. So to evaluate that, the first thing we did is just a simple analysis correlating the rates of upward mobility that I showed you on the map before, plotted here for the 30 largest cities in the United States versus rates of job growth from 1990 to 2010. So how much were the local economies growing over the period when the kids were studying here were growing up? And what you can see is that there's essentially no relationship between these two variables. So in particular, you have cities like Charlotte and Atlanta, which are some of the most rapidly growing cities in America. But when you look at their rates of upward mobility, you see, for instance, that Charlotte, North Carolina, which has become a big finance and tech center of the US, actually has one of the lowest rates of upward mobility among the largest cities in the United States. So why is it that there's no relationship essentially between these two variables? How can you simultaneously be one of the most rapidly growing cities in the US in terms of economic activity, yet have very low rates of upward mobility for kids who grow up there? So the way I think about it is that places like Charlotte and Atlanta essentially import talent. They import talent by bringing in highly skilled people from other parts of the US. They also import talent from other countries. So you might know, for example, that Atlanta has one of the most rapidly growing Asian populations in the United States. And so what's happening is that places like Charlotte and Atlanta, they have all these high paying, high skilled jobs, but the people who are getting them are not the kids who are growing up in low and middle income families in those cities. It's people who were educated or were growing up elsewhere. And so that phenomenon shows you right there, I think, a very simple first lesson, which is that just trying to have a vibrant economy and bringing in big employers, tech firms, things like that is no guarantee that people in that community are likely to benefit and experience higher rates of upward mobility. And my sense is that lesson is likely to be very important in India, where you have cities that are really thriving, but there's a question of whether the lower income folks living in those cities or in surrounding areas are actually benefiting from that growth. So that was hypothesis number one. Maybe this is about just differences in the labor market, and that doesn't seem to be it in and of itself. That's not enough to explain why some parts of the US have much higher rates of upward mobility than others. Second possible explanation. So people who are familiar with the US demography will recognize, going back to the initial map that I showed you here, that there's a potential connection to differences in race, in particular the racial demographics of these different cities. So much of the southeast of the US has a much larger African-American population than the center of the country, for example. Cities like Cincinnati and Detroit, Cleveland have much larger black populations than the rest of the country. Now, we all know in the US that there's a very long history of racial disparities between blacks and whites. And so perhaps part of what we're seeing here is a difference in outcomes between Black and white Americans that's showing up spatially because of the racial segregation in the US, as opposed to a direct effect of place for people of a given race. So what we did next is linked the data from tax returns to data from the Census Bureau that gives us information on race and ethnicity for the entire US population. And that allowed us to construct this pair of maps here, which show you the same set of statistics that I was showing you before, but separately for Black men on the left and white men on the right. And what you can see if you first look at this, this pair of maps is, you know, your initial reaction might be, oh, they've put these maps on two different color scales, kind of a red-yellow color scale on the left and a blue-green color scale on the right. But in fact, if you look at the bottom of your screen, you can see that we have not done that. The maps are on the same color scale. It's just that there is such an extreme disparity in rates of upward mobility in the US between Black and white Americans that you have two essentially non-overlapping distributions, where the very best places for upward mobility for Black men, a place like Boston, for example, where Black men growing up in low-income families go on to earn about $25,000 a year, that has lower rates of upward mobility than the very worst places for upward mobility for white men, a place like Charlotte, North Carolina, where white men go on to earn $25,000 a year, conditional on growing up in a low-income family. And so because of that, you have essentially what look like two different Americas, like two completely different situations in terms of prospects for economic opportunity for Black and white men. So in that sense, there's no understating the importance of race, even conditional on socioeconomic class, in the United States. And I'm going to show you at the end some parallel results in India across caste and by religion that I think echo what we're seeing here in the US by race and ethnicity. So race is extremely important in driving part of what's going on, but you can see that even among white Americans, if you look in the map on the right, there's a substantial difference in terms of rates of upward mobility. For example, here in the Appalachian Hills in a place like West Virginia, you have much lower rates of upward mobility than the rest of the country. So race matters, but place also matters quite a bit conditional on race. So you'll have noticed that here I focused on data just for Black versus white men. If I now look at the same pair of maps for Black versus white women, you see a very different story, which is that the spectrum of colors on these two maps look pretty similar to each other. It doesn't look like there are dramatic differences in rates of economic mobility between Black and white women. And so in particular, the racial disparities in America are concentrated among men. And that's the type of insight that I think you can get from these modern data sets that can be extremely useful in starting to uncover what the drivers are of these disparities. So the fact that there is an intersectionality, to use the term that sociologists would use, between race and gender here, points to potential explanations that we might want to prioritize. Is there something in particular about discrimination that Black men face in particular? Or are there issues with the criminal justice system where you have very high rates of incarceration for Black men, but not for Black women, that could be at play? And it's that type of, I think, very fine-grained analysis that can help us understand what the drivers are of these differences in economic opportunity. So what we've learned so far is that it's not about pure differences in economic activity. It's partly about differences in race. But now the question becomes, why is it that we're still seeing these very sharp differences across places for people of a given race? And so going back to this big map here, the next thing I'm going to do is disaggregate this data and zoom in to a much finer geographic level to understand at what level of geography these disparities are emerging. So when you look at the national map here, your eye naturally gravitates to broad regional differences, for example, between the center of the US versus the Southeast. But what we did next, and I'm going to toggle over here to a web browser, to this website called opportunityatlas.org, which Professor Deshpande mentioned in her introduction, this Opportunity Atlas that we've constructed, an interactive data portal, where I'm starting out showing you the same national map, the same set of statistics on upward mobility that I was showing you earlier in the slides. But now what we can do is enter in any city, actually any address that you would like, and you can access this website yourself if you'd like, by just going to opportunityatlas.org. And I'm just going to type New York to pick a place that may be familiar to many people in India and just zoom in here, literally zoom into the data in New York. And so you can see, for those who are familiar, the familiar outlines of New York. This is Manhattan right here. This right here, where we have no data in the middle, is Central Park. And then, you know, these are the other boroughs of New York, the Bronx, Queens, Brooklyn, and so forth. And so just zooming in here a little bit, the first thing that I want you to see is we're holding the color scale fixed relative to the maps that I was showing you earlier. And so the first thing that's immediately evident is that when you look here at the data census tract by census tract in New York, so we've divided the data up into neighborhoods that consist of about 4,000 people each, so incredibly zoomed in here. And the reason we're able to do this is precisely kind of the big data approach, right? That we have data on millions of kids, essentially everyone growing up in each of these neighborhoods. So we're able to construct these very fine-grained statistics. And what you can see is there are incredibly sharp disparities in rates of upward mobility. You can go from the darkest red colors if you're up here in Harlem, down, if you know, just a few miles on the Upper East Side of Manhattan. You can go from the very low rates of upward mobility that we see in places like Alabama to the very high rates of upward mobility that we see in places like Iowa. So the reason that result, I think, is very important is it shows us that the drivers of these disparities and opportunities are not about differences about in one part of the country versus another part of the country or one city versus another. No, it's actually about differences in what's happening down the street relative to your neighborhood. And I'm going to show you a little bit later some parallel results in India, which, and you know, we've seen similar results now from people doing work in many other countries around the world. And I think what that shows us is that the mechanisms of economic opportunity are not at the national or, you know, broad regional level. They're actually at a hyper local level, a few kilometers down the road, and a fundamental change in life circumstances. And to me, that's actually a very encouraging result, because it shows us that we don't need to look, you know, to a different time period 50 years ago or to a totally different country with completely different systems or completely different demographics. We can actually look just a few miles down the road within our own city and see fundamentally different opportunities for kids, which suggests that these problems might be things that we can actually make progress on through carefully designed changes in economic policy. And so with that, what I'm now going to turn to is to ask, going back to the slides here, what is it that we can do to actually increase rates of opportunity in these neighborhoods where we currently have lower levels of economic mobility? And so to do that, to set the stage and go further, I'm going to show you first a snapshot from the Opportunity Atlas from the city of Seattle in the northwest of the US, where Microsoft is based, where you see a very similar pattern to what I was showing you in New York, where you have incredibly sharp differences in rates of upward mobility across nearby neighborhoods. And I'm going to pick out two neighborhoods that I'm going to focus on for illustration in a second. The Central District, which is right in downtown Seattle, where kids who grow up in low-income families have relatively low rates of upward mobility. They go on to earn about $26,000 a year in their 30s. And contrast that with Normandy Park, a neighborhood south of Seattle, where kids who grew up in low-income families go on to have much higher levels of income in adulthood. So in order to understand what's driving this variation, the next thing we want to do is understand to what extent the differences that we're seeing in these maps are driven by the causal effects of place. That is, to what extent is it the case that if I take a given child and move that child from a place like the Central District to Normandy Park, that I'm going to see a change in that given child's outcomes. So to study that, we wrote a paper where we analyzed about 7 million families that moved across neighborhoods in the US and used that variation to understand the way in which neighborhoods affect kids' long-term outcomes. Rather than going into the statistical details of that study here, what I'm going to do is just briefly summarize what we find in the context of this example, thinking about kids whose families moved from the Central District to Normandy Park. And so to illustrate what we find, I'm going to use this chart here, where I want you to consider a set of kids who moved from the Central District to Normandy Park at different ages, starting with children who move when they're exactly 2 years old. So what we did is essentially trace forward these kids who move when they're exactly two to their mid-30s using the tax records. And we ask how much are those children who move when they're exactly two earning when they're in their 30s. And what you can see is that the kids who move when they're two, if you look at this first doc here, they have average earnings of about $39,000 a year when they are adults. So that's for the kids who move when they're exactly two. Now let's repeat that analysis, looking at kids who move when they're three, four, five, and so on. And what you can see is, I think, a really striking pattern. The later you make that move from the Central District to Normandy Park, the less of a gain you get. And if you move after you're in your early 20s, you get absolutely no gain at all, and the relationship becomes completely flat. So what do you see from this chart? I think there are three key takeaways. First, where you grow up really seems to have a significant effect on your life outcomes. Second, what really matters is childhood environment, where you're growing up rather than where you live as an adult. And third, every year, extra year of exposure to a better childhood environment improves kids' outcomes in the long run. To make a medical analogy, it looks like there's kind of a dosage effect here. If you move to a better area when you're 10 instead of 11 or 15 instead of a 16, you continue to get gains. Every extra year of exposure is beneficial. So what this shows us is differences in local childhood environment at a very narrow geography can really shape kids' prospects for upward mobility in a profound way. So naturally, the next question that's likely on your mind is, what is it then that is different about the childhood environment in a place like Normandy Park relative to the Central District that is leading to these differences in kids' outcomes? And so that's a very challenging question to answer. That basically brings us to the frontier of where this body of research is and what our research group is currently working on and many others are working on. And so what I'm going to do here is, instead of trying to give you the exact answer to that question, I'm going to summarize what we found to be some of the main characteristics of high mobility neighborhoods in the United States. And I suspect similar patterns would be true in India and elsewhere around the world. So what we find is that places with higher levels of upward mobility tend to have lower poverty rates. So they tend to be more mixed income communities rather than places with concentrated poverty. Second, they tend to be places with more stable family structures. So in particular, more two-parent families rather than single-parent families. Third, they tend to be, as you might expect intuitively, places with better schools measured in various ways. And then fourth, they tend to be places with greater social capital. So social capital is a term that people like to use a lot nowadays. What exactly does it mean? I think about the old saying that it takes a village to raise a child as capturing what social capital is about. So we see, for instance, that places with a strong religious community, Salt Lake City with the Mormon Church, it's thought to be a place with a lot of social capital. Places like that tend to be places with high levels of upward mobility. So what you can see from this slide is not a single answer on exactly how we can raise upward mobility in a given area. Rather, this kind of paints a picture that there are many different factors that play into what drives differences in rates of upward mobility across areas. And I think it sets the stage then for thinking about different types of policy interventions that we can undertake to try to increase rates of upward mobility going forward. And so in the remaining few minutes, what I'd like to do is talk about how we can build on the academic research that I've shared so far to try to actually inform economic policy on the ground, to show you how that research translation process is taking place here in the US and hopefully can be done analogously in India. So in light of the evidence that I've shown you so far, the way I would summarize it in one line is basically that the roots of economic opportunity are hyper-local and are related to childhood environment. I think that conclusion would naturally lead you to think about three different types of policy interventions. The first is to try to reduce segregation and basically help people move to higher opportunity areas. If I show you that kids have better prospects of rising up 2 miles down the street in your city, it's natural to ask, well, how can we help more low-income kids move to that part of the city? And so that's one approach you can think about. A second approach is to think about how you can increase economic opportunity in the red and orange colored parts of the maps that I've been showing you. So naturally, it's going to be impossible to help everyone move from one part of a city to another. So how do we ultimately increase rates of opportunity in the lower opportunity parts of a place? And then finally, recognizing that after age 18, for many kids, the key place to intervene is not the house in which they're growing up, but rather the college that they're attending. I think there's an important role that institutions of a higher education can play, like Ashoka University in India and, you know, Harvard here in the US, to amplify the impacts of colleges on upward mobility. So let me briefly talk about the type of work we're doing in each of these domains, and I'm certainly happy to take more questions afterward if people are interested. So I'll start by talking about the approach of reducing segregation. And here I'm gonna go back to the map that I showed you for Seattle from the Opportunity Atlas. And I'm overlaying here in the green dots, the locations where families who receive housing vouchers in the US live, the most common locations where they live. So just a bit of institutional background. In the United States, we have major government programs that allocate about $45 billion a year to provide affordable housing for low-income families. And the idea of those programs is to give families rental assistance to help them move to higher opportunity neighborhoods and hopefully give their kids access to better opportunities. So what we did is first ask, you know, to what extent are these programs actually achieving that goal? And what you can see is that, unfortunately, if you look at where families receiving this rental assistance actually choose to live, you can see that these dots are actually clustered in the red and orange colored parts of Seattle, not the blue, green, higher opportunity parts of Seattle. So despite getting something like $1,500 a month of rental assistance from the government, families are not actually moving to higher opportunity areas. And so a very natural question to ask is, you know, why is that the case? Is it that families want to live in these lower opportunity areas for other reasons? Maybe it's close to their relatives, close to their jobs, they don't want to commute and so forth. Or is it that there's some other set of barriers that are preventing them from moving to higher opportunity areas, even though they would like to do so? Maybe they're having a hard time finding a landlord who will rent to them in these areas, or maybe they just have a hard time going and locating an apartment in those places. And so to show you how this research, I think, can really translate to impact on the ground, what we did when we put out some of this research is got a lot of inquiries from local housing authorities who wanted to figure out how we could use the Opportunity Atlas data to improve the impacts of their programs. And so we designed this pilot study called Creating Moves to Opportunity in Seattle in collaboration with the local housing authorities, which is a randomized trial involving about 1,000 families in Seattle to see whether we could help them move to higher opportunity neighborhoods if they wanted to do so. And so what this program involved was essentially a small amount of assistance in the housing search process, recruiting landlords, having somebody help you find a suitable unit, a little bit of financial assistance to pay a security deposit, things like that, relatively small expenses to see if that type of assistance would change where families chose to live. And this was run as a randomized trial where half of the families just received the standard services when they came in to get their voucher, and half of the families got this additional assistance. And so here are the results of that study. You can see that in the control group, 15% of families or so ended up moving to high opportunity areas, classified as areas in the top one third of the opportunity distribution within Seattle. Whereas in the treatment group, more than half of the families are now living in neighborhoods where we estimate that their kids will go on to earn about $200,000 more over their lifetimes relative to the neighborhoods that the control group families choose. So what that shows you is that a very small intervention on the ground can dramatically amplify and improve the impacts of this, you know, billions of dollars a year expenditure that the government is already implementing to provide this housing assistance informed by this modern data. And so in light of that pilot, there's now been an act proposed and passed in the US federal government by the House and the Senate that authorizes $65 million to do analogous demonstrations to what we did in Seattle in cities around the country. And there's a further proposal to spend an additional $5 billion per year on housing vouchers to help more kids across the United States have better opportunities of succeeding. So that's one, I think, very concrete illustration of how you can start from academic research to constructing this data to pilot on the ground to what I think will be a vastly scaled federal policy that could affect, you know, thousands of kids' lives going forward. So I'm going to be much more brief about the other areas in the interest of time so we can get to questions. We're now doing analogous work, recognizing that that moving to opportunity approach is not fully scalable. We're trying to figure out how we can make place-based investments, looking at a variety of different programs from early childhood interventions to job training programs to things that one can do in local communities, to try to understand using longitudinal data, which of these different approaches are most successful in terms of bang for the buck in improving opportunity in a given area. No concrete results to report yet there, but that shows you, I think, the type of analysis that's feasible with modern data that can shed light on those issues. And then analogously, we're doing work in the higher education space where we have released data for every college in the United States on contributions to upward mobility. And I'd imagine analogous data could be constructed eventually in India, and that would be incredibly helpful. And so just to give you a quick sense of what type of information can be very valuable here, we're showing you here data on every college in the United States. There are about 3,000 of them, that's each dot here. And what we're showing are two dimensions that really matter for a college's contribution for upward mobility. The first is, you can think of as the upward mobility rate of the student body. So among kids from low-income families, students in the bottom 20%, what fraction of them end up reaching the top 20% of the income distribution? And so you can see, for example, that the elite private colleges in the United States, for example, Harvard and Columbia, have very high rates of upward mobility for the low-income kids who attend those colleges. So on that dimension, they're doing great in terms of rates of upward mobility. However, what matters for your contribution for upward mobility in the US as a whole is not just how well the low-income kids you have on campus do, but how many low-income kids you actually have on campus. So what fraction of the students come from low-income families? And on that dimension, you can see that places like Harvard have very few low-income kids currently attending. So kids from the top 1% of the income distribution, families earning more than $650,000 a year, are something like 75 times as likely to attend Harvard as kids from the bottom 20% of the income distribution. So places like Harvard are dominated by kids from very high income families, and as a result, cannot be contributing a whole lot to upward mobility in the US. And so what we're currently working on is understanding how you can sort of move these dots to the right. How can you improve low-income access at places like Harvard and Columbia? And then conversely, how can you go to some of the community colleges in the US that are serving lots of low-income kids and improve outcomes in those places, move those dots up so that they are contributing more to rates of upward mobility as well. And so again, you can see how this very fine-grained data can help us target different types of interventions and understand in a fine way what's going on at our higher education institutions. So I want to take 2 minutes to wrap up here and connect this to some implications for India. And the way I'm going to do that is by talking about some work that two students of ours, former students at Harvard, Paul Novosad and Sam Asher, who are now professors at Johns Hopkins and Dartmouth, have done doing analogous work in India that I think is really interesting and shows you the tremendous potential for the types of data efforts that Professor Deshpande was describing at the beginning. And so here first is a map showing you the geography of upward mobility in India that they have constructed. It's even more challenging to do in India than in the US because you don't have, you know, off the shelf, the tax records that cover the entire population that have been digitized over 30 years and so forth. So they are stitching together a variety of different data sources that you can look at in their paper that I think is really an ingenious and pathbreaking effort. And they're essentially constructing the same type of statistics that I was showing you, the average rates of upward mobility, where red colors represent areas where kids from low-income families are less likely to rise up, and green represents places where kids from low-income families are more likely to rise up. And for me, it was really interesting to see this map, you know, even just at a personal level. My family comes from Tamil Nadu. My parents grew up in very low-income families in Tamil Nadu. And you can see that, you know, it turns out that is an area with one of the very highest rates of upward mobility in the US, very commensurate to the experience my own parents had being able to come to the US for graduate school and so forth and rise up through the Indian education system. So that shows you the broad geography of upward mobility in India. So you can see patterns, kind of very sharp variation analogous to what I was showing you in the US. There's also tremendous variation across groups in India. So in parallel to the black-white racial differences I was showing in the US, I think the analogy in India would be differences by caste or differences by religious groups and Muslims versus others in India. And here they're showing you rates of upward mobility over time for different groups. And what you can see is that for Muslims, rates of upward mobility have fallen dramatically over time, whereas for the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, they have gotten significantly better. And so now there are significant divergences across these groups that I think are very important to understand. Finally, I'll go back to the browser here, similar to how we've constructed the Opportunity Atlas in the US. They've started to do similar things in India, and I'll show you here some data for Delhi that they've put together. And what you can see here for Delhi is, again, you know, look at that spectrum of colors. You can see rates of upward mobility going from some of the lowest levels that we see in India to some of the highest levels. And so all this, you know, is at an earlier stage. They've just started to do this work in the past 2-3 years, but you can already see an echo of the patterns that I was describing in the US. And I suspect that going forward, as people are able to do analogous work, I think thanks to some of the data efforts of places like CETA and elsewhere, we are going to find many similar themes to what I shared in the US. So hopefully some of those results will be useful in thinking about what to do in India as well. And our group very much looks forward to supporting these sorts of efforts going forward in India and elsewhere going forward. So let me stop with that and just end here, noting that all of the information that I presented today is available on this website, opportunityinsights.org, and you're also welcome to email our team if you have any questions or are interested in using the data yourself. So thanks very much, and I will turn it back to you.
That was absolutely first rate and fascinating, as expected. There are lots and lots of questions, some of which you actually already answered in your talk, but I'm going to read out some questions that might benefit from more elaboration. So one is, the numbers are going against the American dream for a lot of people, in your view. In your view, which countries have enabled the equivalent of the American dream?
Yeah, great question. So what we're seeing in the international data, and it's a bit tricky to make comparisons, but our sense is a lot of the Scandinavian countries have quite high rates of upward mobility compared to the rest of the world. So places like Sweden, Denmark, Norway tend to at least historically have had much higher rates of upward mobility than the US. And I would say in the recent past, in the very recent cohorts, I think there's some declines in upward mobility even in those countries. But certainly I think in general, European countries, the Scandinavia in particular, tends to have high rates of upward mobility. Not so much the UK, which looks more like the US, actually. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, it might be tempting to try to draw some conclusions from those kinds of cross-country comparisons. So there's more of a welfare state sort of approach in Scandinavian countries. Government obviously plays a much larger role. But I would be cautious about drawing those kinds of conclusions because there are also many other differences in those countries in terms of the racial and ethnic mix of those countries, other types of differences in terms of historical origins and so forth. And so, as is always the case with cross-country comparisons, there are lots of differences. And that's why I think the ability to be very granular and answer that question, you know, within India or within the US can be more illuminating.
Thanks. There was a question about neighborhoods, but you already answered that in your talk. The next question is, has the share of immigrants to the local population decreased over time in the United States? If yes, could that explain the decline in the American dream?
Yeah, good question. So actually in everything I showed, and I should have clarified this, in particular to avoid complications of the type you described, we were focusing only on people who are US natives, people born in the US. So for analysis of upward mobility, first, there's a simple data reason that you want to do that. If you want to compare kids to their parents, you only have systematic information on their parents' incomes if the kids were growing up in the US, right? Somebody who emigrated from India, we're not going to have their Indian parents' incomes in the US tax data, obviously. And so for that reason, the bulk of what I showed, including that first chart about the fading American dream, that was all for people born in the US. Now, a separate question is, what is the experience of immigrants in the US and how has that changed? That's obviously an important aspect of the American dream that lots of us care about, very relevant to my own family and so forth. And our sense is that there's some similar trends. So immigrants in general tend to have much higher rates of upward mobility than US natives. So we see that people who come from other countries do extremely well, even if they're growing up in lower income families. But that advantage fades quickly. So by the time you're in the second generation of kids here, kids whose parents also grew up in the US, you see very, very similar rates of economic mobility that vary in the same way across areas and so forth to what I was showing you for US natives. So there's a pretty rapid process of assimilation after immigrants arrive.
There's a question from Dr. Sunil Shekhar, who's faculty member at Ashoka, which is, you know, what is it about the neighborhoods that makes some neighborhoods more conducive to upward mobility as opposed to others? And so he asks, is it all correlated with the quality of schools in the neighborhood?
Yeah, it absolutely is. And so, you know, I would just go back to that slide I shared with the four factors that seem to be correlated with these differences in upward mobility. Those four factors together explain something like 75% of the variance in the maps that I was showing you. So it's not just that they're slightly correlated, they're really strongly correlated with these differences in upward mobility across areas. And so just to recap, it is, you know, measures of the quality of schools, poverty rates, measures of family structure. So that's actually the single strongest correlation in the data, it turns out. The fraction of two-parent families in an area is incredibly strongly correlated with differences in upward mobility across places. And then measures of social capital. So I would say schools matter, but they're not the only thing that matter. We see lots of variation in outcomes, even among kids who go to the same school. So US school districts sometimes can span multiple neighborhoods, and you see differences across neighborhoods among kids attending the same school that are correlated with some of these factors that I'm talking about. And so I think schools obviously are a very natural place to try to intervene and make changes, and we should absolutely be focused on that. But I think we also need to think hard about mechanisms like mentorship and aspiration. So for example, you know, what is on your radar screen as a potential pathway to success? We see, to pick one example in the US, you know, for, I pointed out, Black men have very low rates of upward mobility, right? And so we see, for instance, that Black men who grow up in neighborhoods with very few father figures around, so very few Black male adults in the neighborhood, they're much less likely to rise up in the income distribution. The presence of Black fathers in a neighborhood is not related to Black women's outcomes. So why do I say that in this context? That suggests a mechanism that doesn't have anything to do with the schools per se. It's something about what types of pathways one is thinking about. You know, who might be a mentor to you? Do you see a career pathway that you can see yourself following? We see in lots of contexts evidence suggesting that that type of thing could be quite important. And so that's why I think focusing on things like social connections and so forth, in addition to the quality of schools, can be quite valuable.
There's a question from Professor Arvind Subramanian. He asks a question for researchers. Can you please describe the challenges of the sausage making, which we in India might benefit from? That is, what are the challenges you faced in implementing this amazing research agenda?
Yeah, thanks for that question, Professor Subramanian. So, you know, as you anticipate, that's an incredibly challenging thing to pull off. That took a team of 30, 35 people who work in my research lab, who I'm very grateful to for contributing to these efforts. And so just to give, let me lay out, you know, the timeline of a bit of how we did this. So the first step is to actually get access in a secure way to the underlying microdata that is behind all of the maps and the figures that I was showing you, right? So this is anonymized data covering the entire US population over the past 30 years or so that's coming from tax return information that the IRS has collected here. Obviously very sensitive data, among the most sensitive data in the US, protected heavily by law. And so we had to figure out ways to access that data that would not compromise confidentiality or privacy. And so we accessed the data in collaboration with folks in the US Treasury. in secure government servers where everything is monitored, anonymized, and so forth. And using that and modern, server access and so forth, we are able to construct these statistics that we then further protect using what are called differential privacy techniques. So there's a field called differential privacy in computer science now that thinks about how you can release statistics without taking a risk of releasing any one person's individual data. And so we implement a set of algorithms, basically adding a little bit of noise to these statistics that doesn't compromise the statistical reliability very much, but protects, guarantees essentially the privacy of the individual people who are underlying these statistics. And so then after doing all that, we're able to release these statistics publicly. And then we put in, as you can see, extensive effort to try to present the data in ways that will be accessible to the public. So building data visualization platforms like the Opportunity Atlas, which are done by external data visualization firms that we contract with, because that's kind of outside my expertise. I wouldn't know how to make that website. And then try to do analysis that can be informative for policymakers, as you saw, work with people on the ground in housing authorities, in the federal government, and so forth, in schools to try to actually implement interventions. So I would say the broad answer to your question is there's a really kind of big team approach to doing this kind of research. So different from the tradition in economics, which as theory and smaller scale empirical work, one or two people working together, this very much now looks to me more like a lab model of 30, 40 people working together and often working with even larger groups outside the lab. And my instinct is that's the path going forward for our field, at least in certain domains, doing empirical work informed by theory and trying to test theories, but trying to draw upon this large scale data, which I think we can really learn a lot from.
Actually, there's a question about data. I'll come back to that, but there's this question from a student at Ashoka. Is it possible that upward mobility follows some analog of a steady state as in a solo model?
Yeah, so it's, I think, very interesting to think about the dynamics across generations. So far we've had data to really look at dynamics only over one or maybe at most two generations. And you can use that in one of our papers, for instance. We think about the type of question you raised, thinking about the black-white disparities and what the steady state is likely to look like given the transition matrices that we see for black and white Americans at present. And the conclusion we reach is that it looks like blacks and whites are basically in steady state at the moment, meaning if you take the current transition matrix and ask what's going to happen if that transition matrix remains stable over time, where will these income distributions converge? They're going to converge to basically where we are at present. And so the reason that's a useful analysis to do is that it shows us that the current black-white disparity in the US is not transitory. It's not going to disappear unless we fundamentally change rates of upward and downward mobility for black Americans relative to white Americans. And so I think that's a very natural way to think about it and can help us focus our energies and where we should intervene to try to change those steady states in the long run.
There are two related questions. One is from Nicola Gravel, who's a professor at the French Center in Delhi. He's a director of it. Is the observed regional variation in upward mobility simply reflecting the cross-regional variation in per capita income? And the related question is it related to cost of living across neighborhoods?
Yeah. Again, two great potential hypotheses that we thought about along the way. And perhaps surprisingly, the answer is no to both of those. That's not what the key driver is. So when I was showing you, for instance, that initial slide on rates of job growth, I could have equally well put average levels of income, and you would have seen some correlation with that measure, but not a very strong correlation. So let me give you some examples. If you look at much of the center of the US, places like Iowa, for example, or Nebraska, these are rural states without really vibrant job growth centers or job centers like big cities or anything like that. So they wouldn't be the highest average income places. But what's really striking is that kids who grow up in low-income families in those places, they are doing really well and they're moving to a place like New York or Chicago to get high-paying jobs. Now, one of the benefits of our data is we can track people no matter where they are in the US. And so essentially what's happening in a place like Iowa is you're growing up in a middle class or even lower income community, but then for whatever reason, because of the schools, because of the social capital, because of other factors, you tend to have high rates of upward mobility and then move to a place with high levels of income to get that high paying job. But it is not about literally the mean levels of income in a place that is itself driving levels of mobility in a given area. And so that might be surprising, but that's a striking fact that emerges from the data. Another potential hypothesis, differences in cost of living that you mentioned, you know, you might wonder, is it, you know, New York is a much more expensive place than Iowa or Alabama. How is that affecting the analysis that I've been showing you? Let me give you two answers to that question. First, empirically, if we construct cost of living adjusted measures, so deflating by a local price deflator based on rents, cost of groceries, things like that, you get a map that looks basically identical to the one that I showed you. It's correlated 0.91 with the estimates that I showed you. So conceptually, why is that the case? It's because upward mobility is fundamentally about differences between kids and parents' incomes. And most kids tend to live relatively near where their parents lived, okay? So if I take a place like New York, it's true that when you adjust for cost of living, real incomes in New York are gonna look lower for the kids, but so are their parents' incomes. And as a result, when I look at upward mobility across generations, it looks relatively similar. Now, that's not gonna be true if the kid moves to a totally different place, like in the Iowa example I was giving you, from Iowa to New York, but that's relatively uncommon. And as a result, it ends up not affecting the statistics very much.
Okay, now here's a question that actually has implications for affirmative action and inclusiveness. How do you think universities such as Harvard, Columbia can increase their rate of students from low-income families, taking into consideration a strong self-selection issue? Very few students from low-income households have opportunities to make themselves attractive to these elite universities.
Yeah. So great question. It's actually exactly a project we're working on at the moment, both from a research perspective and in collaboration with these universities to figure out what they can actually change. So as that question indicates, the first issue is, what is the pool of applicants actually look like? Are there students who have the qualifications to get into these universities to begin with from lower income families? If that doesn't exist, there's, you know, very little that these universities can do, and you have to think about how you fix the problem earlier in the pipeline. So to address that, what we've done at the moment is linked data on the key standardized tests that students in the US take, the SAT and the ACT, which essentially everyone in the US takes in order to apply to these colleges. We've gotten that data and linked that data to the tax records and to data from admissions files for many colleges across the United States. Mm. Now, I'm gonna be careful here in what I say publicly from these data, because those results are not yet public. But essentially, you know, what we can see from that data is there are, in fact, many students, not an enormous number, but there are many students from lower income families who would have credentials that would be similar to the students currently being admitted to places like Harvard. So it's not like there are zero kids who have high enough SAT scores or grades, et cetera, to get into these places. The question then becomes, why is it that the kids in that pool are not showing up on these campuses? Is it that they're not applying? Is it that they're not being admitted? Is it that they're not choosing to enroll, perhaps because the cost of tuition is too high? And so we are basically step by step trying to analyze at each of these universities where in the pipeline of showing up on campus kids are falling out, particularly kids from lower income families. And we hope to release a study in a few months that will shed light on that. The answer is that I think it's different in different universities. The explanation is different, but I think there are carefully targeted interventions that we can implement that can be cost effective, I should note, in increasing representation. So this is not just about financial aid and trying to spend more money. I think there are ways we can change the process and other dimensions that can be quite effective.
Okay, I think we'll go to the last question now, which was actually asked much earlier on. It's about the bias in data collection. So the question says, what would you say about discriminatory bias in data collection metrics? For example, in India, wealth metrics have conventionally been inaccurate. Additionally, there's a limitation on our ability to collect data from various regions across the country, as well as from who we collect data. do these limitations color our data in limiting ways? Basically, yeah. It's about the accuracy and the absence of reliable data.
Yeah, great question. I mean, obviously, especially an important question in the developing country context. Also an important question, you know, in places like the US, any conclusions you draw are only going to be as good as the quality of the raw data you're starting with. So a few reflections on this. So first of all, I would say that's exactly the motivation for the type of approach we're taking, going back to Arvind's question about, you know, how was the sausage made? The value of looking at sources like the US tax data for the entire population or the census data, which in principle covers the entire US, that's why it's a census. Relative to surveys, you know, they tend to have very high rates of coverage. I don't want to overstate and claim that they are perfect. Certainly there are people who don't file taxes, but even for those folks, there's tax information being filed by employers in the US. So you can get quite a good picture for virtually everybody in the United States, not relying on self-reports. And so I think that can get you quite far. But that said, there can still be gaps in coverage for certain subgroups. And so we spend a lot of time trying to triangulate different sources, benchmarking against surveys, for example, or benchmarking, you know, what you get in the census, who do you cover in the census versus who do you see in the tax returns. And so I think all of those things can be exercises that help. But I think the broader issue is in a country like India, where you can't just take off-the-shelf tax data that's going to cover everybody in the population. You know, what do you do in those types of situations? And so I think the innovations that people are making, which are very exciting, is to use information from mobile technologies, for example, where, you know, even if not everybody is in the formal employment system, essentially everybody is going to have a mobile phone and is going to use that for various financial transactions and aggregate it in the right way. You can potentially get quite a bit of information from that. Often location can itself be a real indicator of someone's well-being and socioeconomic status. Again, not perfect. You know, my view is always no data set by itself can be viewed as the pure truth, right? At the end of the day, even these measures, even if you think tax return data perfectly measure incomes, if you step back and think about it, we don't care just about income. We also care about wealth. And of course, if we look beyond the economic domain, we don't just care about financial well-being. We care about health. We care about overall well-being, right? And we don't have administrative data on that. And so the question is, how good are the proxies that one can construct in capturing the concepts that we care about? And so my sense is that these big data sources, that is data sources that don't fundamentally rely on a survey and active response, kind of the exhaust pipe of the transactions that we all participate in the digital age, that type of data can have quite good coverage and assembled in the right way can serve as useful proxies. So my answer would be, we need to be very alert to the gaps that we might have, and we need to be alert, most importantly, to biases where we might miss certain subgroups or mischaracterize them. But I do think these types of data, at least we feel in the US context, can help us make quite a bit of progress. And I think that's only going to improve going forward as we have more and more digitization.
Thank you very much, Raj. And thanks so much for this absolutely fascinating lecture. There are other questions, but I think we'll end here. And for listeners in India, I think this was very useful for us to realize that you know, circumstances of birth over which a child has no control in fact ends up determining a lot of life chances. You know, so a lot of debates in India, contemporary debates, are shaped around what factors go into making of inequality, and I think the circumstances of birth is a very, very important factor. So we shouldn't just take away lessons from this lecture. Oh, this is the US and in India it's different. It's not at all different. And so, you know, I think that's a very useful lesson for us to learn as Indian academics. So at the end, before we go, I would just like to thank the people who made this possible. So first of all, the Infosys Foundation, who approached us and suggested this lecture. And of course, we were delighted and thrilled to be hosting it. Secondly, members of the CEDA staff, Sonal Agarwal, Ankur Bharadwaj, and Mayuk Nair, the three CEDA staff members, you know, worked very hard to just get everything together and make it possible. And so we really look forward to a meaningful dialogue in future from the point of view of CEDA with Opportunity Insights. And, you know, perhaps, collect some data of the kind that you have, although we know that Indian data sets are not perfect, but it's very inspiring to see what's possible. And even if one can do a subset of that, that still, I think, would collectively go a long way. So with that, Raj, thank you very, very much again for your time and for the insights. Thank you.
Thank you. My pleasure. Thank you, everyone.